Karen, the houses of death.
Their last moments were spent marching across under guard.
Seeing the first siege site.
The site where they were laid siege to. And look over here. And that's where they were massacred.
That's where the massacre.
Were then executed on command under the order of brethren, do your duty, and were shot at point blank range and beaten to death with rifle stocks.
Imagine, I mean, pulling into a valley like this, there's a spring and a stream.
These 74 hours.
I recently read John Krakauer's book, Under the Banner of Heaven. I think in the preface to the book, Krakauer says he called Mormonism a violent faith. And it is. It's a very violent faith. The kind of violence that the Mormons perpetrated here back last, you know, in the 1800s could never happen today. They could never get away with that kind of physical, lethal violence today. But the thought kept occurring to me as I was reading the book that, you know, there is another kind of violence that Mormonism perpetrates, and that's an emotional violence against people. And it is, in its way, no less injurious, no less abusive than what happened here at Mountain Meadows. Entire families have been destroyed by Mormons' insistence that there's something wrong with being gay.
We went to a gay fathers group. And I think it was love at first sight. But we're both pretty domestic. That's really been, you know, part of the attraction.
Work in this small cramped space until we have a bigger place.
We have fresh flowers in the house. It's a nice touch, isn't it?
I love it. This is a guy.
Pass through. Tag the line, go all the way through. Face right. You do a Ferris. Center slide through, back away. Are you home? Heads past the ocean.
We met at a square dance in Phoenix.
Pitch, pull, pull the field.
Load the boat.
And this particular event, Chip was there. However, I did not meet him until the final night with just about an hour and a half left to go.
Promenade short trip. Sides lead right.
A good friend of mine from the Desert Valley Squares, Alan, had been trying to get me fixed up with someone. He said I was too good to be single.
And it's gonna be so different when I read your blog tonight. Head square through four.
I get a tap on my shoulder. It was Alan. He spun me around. He said, John, this is Chip. Chip, this is John.
We danced and we hit it off really well. And we got together.
Now you're an LJ user. Screen is kind of blind. It's a big to-do.
And actually, no sooner had we gotten together than I was off on a three-week trip subbing for a keyboard player on the Les Mis tour that I had just left. I was covering somebody's vacation. So we did a lot of emailing.
Chip and I exchanged, oh my Lord, we exchanged novels with each other of everything.
We carried out a good deal of our courtship online. We talked about all kinds of things, past relationships, what we were looking for in a partner.
Swing your corner, girl, and promenade.
What we were looking for in a relationship, what kinds of things we didn't want. It was fun. It was really cool. And by the time we saw each other again 3 weeks later, a lot of those questions were out of the way, and we could get down to the business of, so, are you the one for me? Let's check it out.
And here we are, 11 and a half years later.
Yeah.
Because somewhere on the net, there's you.
You're now going to enter the crypt, where even the cleaning people won't come. I can't get cleaning people to clean up my office. It's so dirty. I mean, everybody has their limits, apparently. I don't. I'm a cartoonist. We've had some teacher scandals in Arizona recently. A teacher's having sex with their students. Teacher's pet, 1967. Teacher's pet, 2007. Things have changed a bit.
And now, Fearless Talk Radio. Here's Charles Goyette.
Yes, it is the Charles Goyette Show, where, as we say, you are invited to clear the bench, to get off the bench and join the fray. Hey, but tell me, what's the Falwell cartoon say?
Well, you know, it was interesting listening to the Talking Heads chatter last night, saying that what a great guy Falwell was, and that James Dobson from, Focus on the Rabbit Family out of Colorado Springs was saying, in response to the criticism that Falwell has targeted feminists and gays and lesbians and secular humanists and atheists and pagans and abortion doctors and blamed them for 9/11. And the critics of Falwell say, this is hate speech. And Dobson's defense is, yeah, but it's in the Bible. Okay, it's hate speech in the Bible. I want to do a cartoon, Jerry Falhell, where you have him actually walking into the flames of the underworld with a little devil's tail and horns, and I was told by the editor that was too close to his death. I said, hello, hello, it's close to his death. That's why I'm doing the cartoon.
Steve bought this home recently, and he knew that I had done landscaping professionally for a lot of years, even though I basically retired from it. And he asked if I would come out and help him with the place. And so what we're doing is building a turtle pond, because Steve is totally infatuated with turtles and tortoises.
Visitors are welcome. Gay people need not apply. I think it says that in smaller letters.
Yeah, it does. Right at the bottom of it.
Gays need not apply.
It's only about the and here you got Tom in the greenhouse. There's a little, reality in Mormonism. It's what we call greenhouse Mormonism. The active, devout, faithful Mormons like to be sequestered, run to the protection of the greenhouse, where they're beautifully cared for.
Nurtured, fed.
They get all kinds of
warmth.
Yeah, they get what? The fertilizer, the BS from the pulpit. Anyway, they blossom, they look beautiful, but they're very, don't go away, Tom. They're very, vulnerable.
Delicate. See how these all got burned with the frost?
Why? Because they were outside.
That's what happens to greenhouse Mormons.
Mormons do well in a carefully controlled environment.
Yes.
Tom used to be a greenhouse Mormon.
Yeah, for 15 minutes when I was born.
He could handle it. And his strength of character has come through the hard-bitten reality of digging deep within the soil of the real world, finding out who he is, and rooting himself in the real world.
That's why the roots on the bottom of my foot represents being rooted, grounded.
That is not a greenhouse Mormon foot.
No. That's funny. We're probably about as different as two people can get in a lot of ways, but that's part of what makes it so easy, you know?
No, we're different. I'm smart, you're not.
Yeah, that's a good starting point. I'm gay, you're not. I consider gay to be a would you call it? A privilege and a boon.
What do we have in common?
What do we have in common? Interesting mothers.
So that's how my mother helped me develop my gaydar. Anybody with big brown eyes, or anybody who's circumcised, watch out.
Mm. My mom, one time in high school, I was walking through the living room and she said, stop sashaying like that.
We're both artists.
Is this a great job or what? One of my colleagues, Mike Peters, of the Dayton Daily News, said we get paid to do now what we used to get sent to the principal for. Can't do that, huh?
Yes, there you go. That's it, exactly.
Pablo Picasso said that art is not done to decorate apartments, but to wage war against the enemy.
And Tom being, a square peg in a round hole when it comes to Mormonism and his sexual orientation, and myself being the same way in terms of rejecting the myths and deceptions of Mormonism, just have found a common bond in mutual pain.
This is going to be an amazing backyard when it's finished. It's just going to be gorgeous.
Well, there's Steve's social life, which is a story. I mean, you know, he's got, you know, a couple hundred close friends.
Once I was relieved of having to spend every minute on Mormonism, was able to create kind of a network of people that actually had value to me. But if there's something comes up in our life, I can, within probably 5 minutes, think of three people at least that could help with the situation.
I mean, other than that, it's mostly us and the kids.
So it'll be nice to be in a house that'll have space for everyone, because then we'll be able to actually be together.
He's probably showing houses this afternoon.
Well, I'm a square dancer who actually is a musician in New York. I'm a Broadway musician. I play piano. I do some conducting. I wasn't born Mormon. I was not born into an LDS family. I converted as a teenager. I was a questioning, searching young person. I also got to know a very nice Mormon family in my hometown. And in particular, and I have to admit this, there was the middle boy in that family was a year older than me, and I had a crush on him, so that had something to do with it too. Point on, I was 15 when I was baptized. From that point on, I pretty much worked towards going to BYU. It was the only college I applied to. I was accepted, early acceptance, so I went.
I grew up in Italy, where, and all over Europe for that matter, where there was absolute freedom. Freedom to be however beautiful, however outrageous, however clever, however funny, however quiet. Absolute freedom. And when we moved back to Southern Idaho in the late 60s, it was like running into a brick wall, 100 miles an hour into a solid brick wall. And it completely devastated me.
Things were pretty good when I was a young kid, but as soon as I started to realize what was going on, the moment I made the connection between who I am inside and how that was totally wrong with the church, everything got really dark.
I've told people before that as long as I live, if you cut me, to some extent I will bleed my Mormon heritage. That's something that, you know, we come into life innocent and open and vulnerable, and we imprint on the mama duck. And in my case, the mama duck was a big furry bird called Mormonism, and that mama duck led the way, and in my family of pay, pray, and obey, we followed in line, in step, given our marching orders by the prophets of God, one of whom happened to be my grandfather. Growing up in Mormonism is really a experience in prejudice. Prejudice is action and thought based on ignorance.
There was the life course that's mapped out for you by the church. You know, you get your education along the whole way. You pay tithes and you live the teachings of the church and you keep yourself pure. And then if you're a boy, you meet a girl. It's got to be a girl. Can't be another boy. Not allowed. But I wasn't thinking in those terms. You know, I was pretty vague about this whole meeting a girl thing because I didn't understand how it worked. I honestly didn't understand how it worked. But I knew that was supposed to be part of the plan. And then you get married and you hopefully get a job about the same time maybe or something. And you do whatever it is that it takes to raise a family. You somehow make children. I swear I was so ignorant. That was about as specific as I could be about what I wanted.
I began forcing myself to be straight when I was 12, even though it wasn't totally clear what it was that was different. When I was 12, I had my first girlfriend. When I first moved into dating girls or even contemplating it, I was just watching other people. Only watching other people, only figuring out what they were doing to see if I could look normal.
That was where the damage was done. That was where Mormonism attempted to tame what was already untamable.
When I was a young child in Mormonism, homosexuality was an aberration. It was taught as being a sin. I didn't have any personal experiences with gay or lesbian people growing up. I was warned to stay away from circumcised boys who were in the shower room with me, because if I was not careful, they would prey upon me and that they would try to convert me to homosexuality. So early in my career at the Arizona Republic, based upon my ignorance and from that the prejudice that results from ignorance, I did these incredibly stupid, embarrassing, shameful and shameless editorial cartoons blaming gays for the spread of AIDS and for, you know, burdening the rest of the planet with it.
A real wrench was thrown in that when along the way I discovered really, I mean, I'd always known I was attracted to boys, but I didn't know what that meant. I was very naive. And then when finally these feelings sort of exploded into accidental hookups, I'll just put it that way, because at first, they're complete accidents. You don't know what's going on. You think, what did I just do? And then you have the whole guilt thing, and you have to think, well, this doesn't fit in the picture, so how do I make myself continue to fit in the picture? Well, I have to set that aside. Oh, I have to confess to the bishop.
I didn't feel normal, and as the years went on, it became very clear what it was. I knew for sure I was gay 2 months before I went on my mission. That's when I was old enough and aware enough to figure out that I was gay. And I had one of those moments where I had to decide if I was going to go on my mission or not. The pressure got too high for my parents, and I said that I would. that really started me just an ostrich with my head in the sand.
My Mormon born and bred homophobia was a result of my ignorance. And I'm not using that as an excuse, but that's the way it was.
Kind of. Well, we found the house that is going to work out just right. It has all the room that we need, and it has a big yard, and it's perfect. When we separated 3 years ago, we decided to do what was called nesting or co-parenting. And that means that the parents move in and out of the house and the kids stay in the house. We just figure out on the schedule every day who's here. So any of the kids or anybody who needs to know according to the date knows what time. Who's doing the school drop-off, who's here during the day, who's picking the kids up, who's here during the night. After Rex and I dated for a little while, we came up with an arrangement where I would stay until all the kids were in bed, and then I would leave on those nights and just go sleep at Rex's house. So I only spend the night once a week here at the kids' house, and according to state law, that's abandonment. And that was a huge risk for me, because if we didn't trust each other enough to know what was going on, she could easily go and divorce me and get the kids full custody. She could get that right now, at any moment. Real maple. There you go, buddy. www.godhatesfags.com. Sodomy is an abominable sin worthy of death. Sodomites are proud of their sin, gay pride. And in that prideful state, they cannot repent. You cannot repent of something you're proud of. Let's see what it looks like in Spanish. Oh! Hate in Spanish. So much preparation goes into getting them all out of the house.
Ooh, did I tell...
Really cool looking inside. So this is the place that we are going to live. We've been looking around for months, and finally we found something that will work. We were able to see it last night, really? Yeah, and it was everything that we were looking for, so Rex started the process and put a contract on it. I think he put it out last night or maybe this morning, I'm not sure. And so it's probably going to be about 30 days until we can get in there, and then we'll have all 6 kids in one place, and we'll go furniture shopping.
Are you around?
I want a movable bed.
You want a what?
A movable bed.
A movable bed.
Where you like press the button and then go like that. Like your feet can go like that.
I thought that was for like 90-year-old people.
My daughter, you know, who is just absolutely the most exquisite person on earth, and that I have this beautiful, beautiful relationship with.
He and I would go off and go on adventures or go on road trips. He was the one that braided my hair in the morning. But, you know, other than that, I think it was a pretty maybe typical daddy-daughter kind of relationship.
We went for a walk around Lake Hollywood, sat on a log by the dam, and I said, you know, didn't know quite how to say it, but I just thought I'd just be honest, you know. So, your mom and I aren't going to be together anymore. And it's not that we don't like each other, it's just that, you know, we can't live together anymore. And she said, I understand. And then I said, you know, and now that your mom and I aren't going to be together anymore, I'm probably going to be dating guys, too. And she goes, that's okay, Daddy. She reached over and patted me on the leg and said, that's okay, Daddy, I understand. She grew up in Hollywood. She was 2 years old when we moved to Hollywood. So, you know, half the people that she knew growing up were gay. So gay was a non-issue to her. And at 9 years old, it was like she was comforting me. Pulled two babies out from between her legs. I mean, I don't know a whole lot of dads that, you know, that do that.
Well, let's see. Max was, how old when I left? 10 years old when I left the church. I was a very zealous person in the church.
We get along better now than before when we were Mormon and stuff. So he's just a lot more open and it's cool. And he can let me do stuff with my clothes and my hair and whatever I want, pretty much. Well, not whatever I want, but, you know, it's fun.
I forced him to bear his testimony only once. And I have felt and still feel like that was the worst thing I have ever done to my child, any of my children. But I put so much pressure on him to go up and bear his testimony. It was around that time, actually. And he went up and was so nervous, and I coached him and coached him. And he started to speak, and his voice boomed in the microphone, and then he became embarrassed and felt humiliated and started to cry. And stopped and came down, and I thought, oh my God, what have I done? It was terrible. And I never, ever pushed that again, and within a year and a half or 2 years, I was gone.
What is the doctrine of the Mormon Church with respect to homosexuality? What does the church say?
The church believes that everyone is born heterosexual, and that you have an eternal spirit that's either male or female, and that's the way God created you before he gave you your physical body, but he created you spiritually, and you lived in heaven, and you're born here. You're wired, you're physically constructed, and you are genetically designed to be heterosexual. So the Mormon Church is very ironclad and dogmatic, and unbending doctrine is that if you claim you're a homosexual, you are sick. What's happened with regard to people of same gender orientation is that you see suicides and depression and family dysfunction and real mental trauma and emotional meltdowns caused by a church that so stridently condemns people for who they are.
My ex was a virgin when she marries me, and I'm a virgin to women.
On our wedding day, I was standing there with a full, open, loving heart, suppressing nothing. I don't even think I had any secrets at that stage in my life. You know, so I was coming into it with this just, I mean, I just don't think I could have loved anybody more.
My first experience was 1 week before we eloped because I was so curious and thought actually to myself, if I just get this out of my system, then I'll never have to worry about it again. And 1 week later when we eloped and we consummated our marriage, I knew I was in trouble. Oh my God. That wasn't at all as sparkly as the week before.
Year four in my marriage, I told my wife first on the telephone when she was visiting some friends who were lesbians. I thought the situation was gonna be good because one, I was too scared to tell her face to face, and two, I thought because she was with people who were gay, that it would go well. It was terrible.
And he was crying and sobbing. And my first reaction was, the marriage is over, you need to get your things out of the house. And then, you know, within 24 hours, I started thinking, wait a minute, how can he be gay? We have this great sex life. He seems attracted to me.
I wasn't sure if I wanted to lose the marriage. I wasn't sure what was going on, really. But I definitely wanted to be honest. I was ready to face it, but I was weak. And she showed back up. And my parents showed up, and everybody had the same message, and that was, you can't give up on us. That was the message. And everybody in my entire life fed me that message, and it felt dire, and it felt like I would let the entire world down and they would all not live anymore if I made that decision. And so there was about 2 month period where I felt really low and very terrible because I knew I was going to give up again and start, just jump back in my box and start faking it again.
I think it's significant that my family, my parents, my siblings, are all dead. And, you know, I think the biggest trauma Steve had was related to his family and being forced basically to make a choice between being gay or being with his family.
As I was feeling that I was going to, just by being a gay guy and having Max, I thought I was going to corrupt him. I felt like I was going to ruin him. And so the biggest impetus in me for even saying anything was the fact that I had a baby boy. And I felt in my diseased state as a Mormon that by being even around him, I would bleed onto him. I would make him like me. And so that's really what drove me to say something. And the fact that I just felt terrible about being married to a woman and I was obviously gay. Before you're told about the group, the shaming happens. The shaming consists of you having to confess what you're going through with a member of the church. And to get the courage to be able to do that is huge, because you know the moment you say that word is going to be immediate judgment. And you're not really sure, you're hoping there's going to be some love or some understanding, but there really isn't any love or understanding. They think they're showing love, but what they're doing is isolating and shaming you.
Oh, I have to confess to the bishop. Well, I did that. I confessed to my bishop at the time, and he told me to go to LDS Social Services. And LDS Social Services has counselors who tell you, they give you advice on how to conquer homosexuality, because of course homosexuality is not supposed to be right, it's not of God, it's something to be avoided, it's only behavior, you gotta fix yourself.
My bishop at the time in Salt Lake City sat me down and said, you know, if you give us the names, addresses, and phone numbers of all the people that you've had sex with here in Salt Lake, we'll let you off with just being disfellowshipped. If you don't cooperate and don't give us that information, then you will automatically be excommunicated. And I couldn't believe what I was hearing. And I stood up and I said, you do whatever you want to do, but I came in here to talk about me and to confess my sins. And I'm not about to give you information about the people I've been having sex with. A few weeks later, I was back in his office. And he said, so have you come to your senses about this? He said, because I'm sure, and this is the part that was so unbelievable. He said to me, I'm sure you can appreciate how embarrassing it's going to be to sit in church and sacrament meeting and have your name read that you've been excommunicated. He said, I'm sure you can appreciate how horrified and embarrassed your parents will be and your family will be when they have to tell all of their friends that you've been excommunicated.
By the time I was in my late 20s, I said, enough. I'm not going to do this anymore. I'm not going to live being told that I was one step above a murderer.
I kept asking myself, why do I want to be somewhere I'm not wanted? Why do I keep hanging around this? They don't want me here. They think I'm one step above a murderer. Given half a chance, they would do anything in their power to turn me into a heterosexual.
So we are heading down to the library.
Hello. Yes, I am.
Where I used to come every week, once a week, for many, many years, to meet with the Evergreen group in Denver.
Evergreen International is the cure ministry for gays and lesbians in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Because of Evergreen's connection with Latter-day Saint doctrine, they, like leaders within the church, are teaching that God has only placed ducks on this earth, and that only ducks can get back into heaven to live with God. There is no room in the Evergreen program to admit that there can be geese or swans on this earth who simply cannot turn themselves into ducks. On December 14th, 1973, every swan and goose in America went to bed thinking they were sick ducks. By the close of business the next day, however, the American Psychiatric Association had determined that they weren't in fact ducks, but swans and geese. Just like in the story told by Hans Christian Andersen, these modern-day swans and geese thought that they were ugly and unattractive because they didn't look and act like the ducks. Even still, without any new science to support reparative therapy, Evergreen International began its ministry in 1989, 16 years after the American Psychiatric Association removed homosexuality from its list of mental disorders.
For a while, we met actually in a church building, but then it became very uncomfortable to do that, because we would run into people that we knew, or they would ask us what we were doing, or, you know, whatever. I just really hate that building. It makes me feel very uncomfortable. My bishop sent me to a counselor and said that I could not trust any non-LDS counselors. I was funneled straight into the LDS social services system. I sat in front of him, and he tried to see if I would open up about how I was feeling. And I did, and I started to discuss what it was that I was feeling. And then he stopped me mid-sentence, and he said, "Do you see how you sound?" I feel like in that one moment when he shamed me, I immediately snapped back into my good member mode. He started down a conversation about how this was the road to destruction, and that if I continued to allow myself to feel those things, I would be destroyed. I couldn't go anywhere else. I was immediately trapped into a church situation where the only people I could talk to were my bishop and the LDS social services, and then they funneled me into Evergreen.
Well, he had counseled with the bishop and I had counseled with the bishop, and things kind of got rolling towards the reparative therapy and the support group. And, you know, we just kind of got on the path of that's what we were doing.
My name is Barbara Levitt. I was married to a gay man. They, the members of my church, were telling me to break up my family unit and to stop loving my husband, that he was evil and of the devil because he is gay. In the Mormon church, we are told that families are forever. I was told, "It's too bad you can't love Lester anymore." To be told to leave Lester, to quit loving him, to tear the children away from him, was and is inconceivable to me. Love does not judge, it just is.
I'm just another gay man who came out late in life with four kids and married. I'm seventh generation Mormon. My great-great-grandfather had three wives and 26 children, 21 of them were boys. In my small town, I was related to 65 out of 120 kids in my graduating class. This is not a high school where you want to come out and say, I think I might be gay. I almost left the church at the age of 18 to try and explore that side of me that was screaming for attention. But as Robert Frost said, when two roads diverged in a yellow wood, I was not like Robert Frost, and I chose the road more traveled by, and I chose to toe the line, serve a mission, come home, search for an eternal companion, which was mandatory, I think.
January 5th, 1993, I went and talked with my bishop when I lived in Denver. And that had been the first time since being at BYU that I'd really talked with an ecclesiastical leader about orientation. He introduced me to LDS Social Services, and I started going to counseling there. And the counselor told me about a chapter of Evergreen that had just gotten going in Denver, and so I was all about, sign me up, let's do this, let's work on what I need to work on, except much more naively than that. I was very naive.
At first, to get the whole thing started, there was a leader, I think it was, I'm not sure who it was, maybe it was a bishop or something at first, but once they kick it off, it's all the men in the group lead it.
I was told that it could make me straight, that so I could go on to marry a woman and have a family and do all that stuff. So I started going to Evergreen in January of 93, and I walked into the High Council room where the other, five guys were. Steve was one of them. I remember what I was wearing. I was definitely wearing gay clothes. For me, it became the first place ever I could really sit down and talk about who I was and what I was feeling and what I was experiencing.
So you get all the materials from someplace in Salt Lake, and every week you would follow all those materials. And so it looked, you know, the graphics, everything looked exactly like a church manual. Everything looked exactly LDS.
And then the things that were explained to me certainly seemed to make sense. And they're the typical reparative therapy things of distant father, overbearing mother, rigid social structure. Okay, if you want to talk rigid social structure, talk more in church.
Church. And you'd have to set the tone, and you'd have to start with a prayer, and then there would be parts of the program where you would talk about the difficulties you had, which was turned out just like a testimony meeting, except, you know, gay, which is kind of weird. And then you started talking about what could you do in those situations to not get yourself in trouble. Don't go to the restrooms where there are men where you can pick up. Don't, you know, go to college campuses because there's a lot of stuff that happens there. Don't do all of these things. Don't get yourself into a place where that's going to occur.
The lessons were about how to change, about what was wrong with you, about white-knuckling it, about not masturbating, thinking about guys.
I have to say that the few times, it was just a handful of times that I went to see an LDS therapist, their advice to me was either along the lines of, fast and pray and get your life in order and be as righteous as you can in the ways that you can control, and, you know, the Lord will help you with your testimony and will help you overcome these feelings or these impulses. That was one kind of advice I got. Another kind of advice I got was, and I don't know if I can say, well, you can edit this out if it's too blue, but one fellow I talked to said, don't beat yourself up about masturbation. I know we say masturbation is wrong, but he said, don't beat yourself up about it. Even I did it when I was young, and I thought, oh, I didn't need to know that. But then he said, just make sure you're thinking about girls when you do it.
Doing butch things, about getting rid of things that might be associated with being gay. Like at the time I had this fantastic double-breasted purple suit that I loved, but I got rid of it because that's about the gayest thing you could have. It was great though. All of those things are just who I was, though.
And I thought, this guy doesn't get it. He's supposed to be helping me, but He doesn't get it. Just think about girls. That's not how it works.
Notice how they never turned the spotlight on the structure as being the thing that was wrong.
No, that's one thing I've
realized.
It's
always turn the knife at yourself, turn the knife at yourself. There were 15 total men that would come when we first started. And then it dwindled, and then kind of, you know, more would come in, and some would leave, and you'd never see them again. There was a man in the group that I knew from when I was a kid. As a matter of fact, his sister, Stephanie, was my first kiss. Another part of the program, this was spectacular. Another part of the program was that the reason that we had same-sex attraction is because we didn't grow up doing normal things. We were kind of sissy, and we didn't do sports.
Hey, chase my ass.
Catch it!
What does this have to do whether I like, you know, dick or pussy? Not a thing.
Maybe they think by playing sports, it makes you horny. But, you know, not just for girls.
But it does make you hotter. I have to agree with that. It does make you more aggressive, actually.
Uh-huh.
After blocking all evening,
uh-huh,
I got in the car and I had to listen to hard rock, and I was just craving a steak by the time I got home. So I'm
that's
like, okay, aggression is good, but it has nothing to do with my orientation.
You just wanted steak more.
Exactly.
So I'd like to do that really hot way, you know?
Whoa. Ooh.
Ooh. Now we're throwing straight. Maybe that's what they mean.
I had a friend at the time, well, she's still my friend, but she was the one that I confided in right away. And she felt like over time, like Steve just never even seemed gay, less gay than ever after the reparative thing. I mean, she would say that. I don't even see anything in him anymore that even seems like it could be gay.
They trapped you in by telling you that they could cure you. And then in the end, it was just a settling into the knowledge that you were saddled with this problem, that this is the problem Heavenly Father gave you, that you had to deal with it, and then it was just like being an alcoholic. Every single day, you were one action away from blowing your salvation forever. After a while, you know, there was just nothing left inside. You just there was just like the social connection with the people you were meeting with, but outside of that, it was giving in to just really just a depression, a feeling like there was just nothing you could do, that this was your thing and you were stuck with it, and if you ever gave in, you were gonna go to hell. So
I was torturing myself about the differences between what it meant to be a good priesthood holder, a good Mormon, and these feelings that I had, which I couldn't seem to keep myself from acting on occasionally, followed by bouts of guilt and all of that stuff. And it was a cycle. And the cycle was actually putting me into a kind of depression. And there was nobody that I could talk to that seemed to be able to help.
I stopped the pain by telling the Mormon Church to go fuck itself.
I didn't feel like I was allowing myself to have any extension outside of my own clothing. That's what it felt like. Because I had those garments on, and because of the marks, and because of all the really bizarre circular craziness of the garments and the marks, to the secret handshakes, to the secret passwords, to being worthy to do it, to carry my card, just to go in and be threatened by Satan during the ceremony, to feel like I've got to get back there, get back in the temple again. It's one nasty, nasty cycle. It's one big, huge, nasty cycle that pulls you away from anything real and sticks you into this bizarre belief system. You can't extend your thoughts beyond your clothing. It was just like having a really fucked up force field around my body that did not allow me to take in anything real anymore. That's exactly what those garments did to me. I don't know how many people felt that way, but I tell you, that is some weird, that is a cult tactic that works. It worked for me. If they're managing all the way down to your damn underwear, then what, they've got you literally by the nuts.
What we, I think, as individuals, humanely committed to respecting others need to do, however, is recognize our prejudices and replace prejudice with information, with knowledge, that frees us from the ignorance of our past and our present. I have a curious mind, at least I hope I have a curious mind, and I have an intense interest and respect for scientific methodology and evidentiary proof that can be tested, that can be observed, that can be replicated, that can be falsified, that can be examined. So I looked at the increasing scientific evidence for the genetic basis for sexual orientation. And it became increasingly clear to me that gays are that way because they were born that way. Now this goes completely contrary to the Mormon dogma that your spirit is eternal. It was created heterosexually and will forever be heterosexual. And that's just the way things are. But that's not what the science shows.
I started to withdraw from my friends a little bit. I mean, I would still do things with them, but there was always this wall. And I would find myself thinking, I would be out with them, outwardly having a good time, my singer friends, my music friends, my drama friends. And I would think to myself, and I remember even forming the words in my head, if they only knew who I really am, what I'm really like, if they only knew that, they wouldn't like me. They'd hate me. They'd revile me. This is what I thought.
Even, my relationship with my ex, it didn't matter how many times I was having sex or trying to have an intimate relationship with her. I'm a homosexual, and so I could never reach any true depth anywhere in my life.
Most people go into it with at least a fighting chance. And I felt like we never had really a fighting chance.
Still, I guess you could call me an evergreen graduate, because I was able to do what they advocate, and that is to shut down emotionally so that I did not act upon my same-sex attraction. For 24 years, my wife knew there was a part of me that she could not get to. There was a wall that she could not get over or around or through. In October of 2004, I told her what was behind that wall. I asked Barbara if I could allow myself to have men like me as friends without violating my marriage covenants. Yes, I asked permission from my wife to have men as friends. From the time I was 3 years old, in the church you are taught to avoid the mere appearance of evil, and if you are attracted to men, then you need to avoid men, and I did that. Finally, at the age of 44, I started making friends with men like myself. My wife noticed the difference immediately. For over a year, she saw how alive I could become when allowed to be my authentic self and still honor my marriage covenants.
For the next 16 years, I tried to manage it and probably cheated every 6 months, if not more than that, by going to places where other confused married men go.
Any time that I cheated or acted out or whatever you want to call it when I was married was always just, you know, hit and run. It was always a situation where you just go into, you know, I always just go to an adult bookstore and there'd be, married men just wandering around hoping they could find somebody like themselves and go into a booth and have sex, basically. Nothing about that was real except that I was experiencing the appropriate orientation that I was driven to.
And if you want a low point, I suppose it would be the time that, let's say I committed an indiscretion and it was sort of found out that I had committed this gay indiscretion, and actually kind of because of that I was disciplined and suspended. And we all pretended it was something else. Everybody who didn't know about it was something academic or whatever, but it was really because I had been caught. And I won't go into any more detail than that, but that was a pretty low point, because not only was I suddenly not in school, but I was having to invent this lie about why I was, and just hope that over time somebody would decide that I had repented enough that I could get back into school. That's another reason it took me so long to graduate.
I was mentally thinking about it almost every minute of the day, but I was just playing the part of the perfect Mormon guy. Well, you know, I mean, from externally I looked like I really had it together. I was taking calls from bishops and state presidents. I was the poster boy for Evergreen for many, many years. And if I abstained or stayed away from it, I got more mentally crazy. You go cruising in parks like this because there's nothing left, and all you want to do is feel something because you feel dead.
And alone.
And alone. Dead and alone, and you think, well, if a man touches me, I feel better.
What gay person in their right mind would say to themselves as they got up in the morning, you know, I want to have a good day today. I think I'll go out and announce to the world that I'm gay so that people can stone me, ridicule me, make fun of me. If I'm a gay student up in Wyoming, strap me to a fence, leave me to die after they've beat me because of their homophobic fears. Obviously, the sexual orientation of these men and women is so strong and is so important to their identity and to their sense of self that they will risk anything, even their lives, their reputations, their careers, their families.
Cicadas, if I understand right, the larvae go underground and stay underground for 7 years and then reemerge as adults and breed and die, and it's this process of going underground for long periods of time. It's the 10-year anniversary this morning of Les's death. My lover Les, who I was with for several years. He died in my arms here in the cabin, just up there. And sort of an amazing thing to be back here on the 10-year anniversary. I didn't anticipate being here. This was very much like the day when he died. You know, it was big puffy white clouds in the sky, and rain had washed, you know, into the creek, and the cicadas were just singing their hearts out. We finally called the mortuary to have them come and pick up his body, and we had all spent time with his body and dressing him and preparing him and saying our goodbyes, and the guy from the mortuary arrived, and Ori, my daughter, who was 15, almost 16 at the time, she took me by the arm and she said, "Dad, let's go for a walk." She was protecting me. She got me out of the house and down here to the stream so that they could put him in a body bag and get him in the car and take him away. And I remember as we walked back up to the house, we got up there just in time to see the hearse pulling out of the dirt driveway and sort of that plume of dust billowing up behind the wheels of the hearse, and I watched as it pulled away, knowing that they were taking him away.
In 1985, I had just returned from a trip with the Young Ambassadors. We'd gone to the Middle East, and I think it was on the plane. I remember thinking to myself, I'm not going to try anymore. It's not getting anywhere. I'm not going to fight anymore against who I am. Whatever I am, That's how God made me. Surely he would find some way, or help me find some way, to make me not be what he made me. But I'm not finding it. And so my thinking started to turn around at that point. And that, I guess I would call that my coming out moment to myself.
And I got naked one day. Just took my clothes off and came out here and started walking around. And with my dog and my cat with me. My dog Stetson and my cat Grizzly. And it became a ritual that sort of took on a life of its own. And I spent the better part of the 2 years when it was warm enough naked here. Hiking naked in the mountains, hiking naked along the stream, living naked. I would get up in the morning naked. I would go to sleep at night naked. I would never have a stitch of clothing on ever, except if FedEx or UPS came to make a delivery. Or my friends would come to visit and I would say, you know, I'm naked these days, and if I won't put on clothes for you, so if you have a problem with it, don't come visit, because I'm not going to get dressed, because that's just the way my life is right now.
Nobody wanted to hear about it. Nobody wanted to talk about it. They just wanted me to say, I'm working on it, and it's okay. And that worked for everybody but me.
I had lost everything. My lover, my cameras, my jobs, my car, my everything was gone. And I just sort of remember one day looking up at the sky and going, you know what, fuck you, universe. Come and get the rest of me. Here, the clothes are gone. This is me. I'm naked. You want me? Come and get me.
Well, you're doing everything you can to hang on. It's,
right.
It's sort of like rock climbing.
Right.
A flat
you're
concrete
on the wall.
Wall.
Right.
You're hanging on, and there's nothing to hang on to, but you're hanging on, and it's taking all your strength to just hang on. And as far as going up goes, I mean, it takes all your strength just to hang on. There's
right.
There's no going up. You're there.
Right.
And when actually over here, there's actually a nice little path that leads out of the canyon.
One of the rituals that I got into over the years was to come out hiking, and I'd hike up as high as I could go, and I would stand there in this amazing space.
After almost 2 years since first telling my wife of my struggles, I fell in love with one of my best friends. And I knew in that moment that I could not continue on in that path without being unfaithful to her. I did the only thing I know how to do, and that was to follow the Evergreen program and shut off the switch again. After 3 months of this, my sweet Barbara came up to me and asked me what had happened. Slowly I explained it to her, and we both cried because we knew what it meant. I did not have the courage to divorce, but Barbara did.
The grief threatened to destroy me. And something inside of me just said, I ain't going. I ain't going. I don't know where he's gone to, but I don't want to go there. I'm here. I like it here. I finally learned how to have fun. He taught me how to have fun, how to enjoy myself, and have a normal life up fishing and baking cookies and making music and having a good life together. And I'll be damned if I'm just gonna like go down without a fight.
Now, it's just not scientific evidence that has moved me to where I am today, but also actually breaking down the walls of prejudice and ignorance by having horror, actual contact with brown-eyed people who happen to be gay, blue-eyed people who are gay people who are gay. I came to admire and accept gays for who they were. Genuine people who had feelings and passions and despairs and hopes and dreams and frustrations and weaknesses and strengths, just like everybody else.
I am a gay man, so I need to find out what that means. I need to find out what it really means, not what the church tells me it means. I did manage to graduate without getting into further trouble, and then I moved from Provo to the big bad city of Salt Lake, where at least you can find other gay people and socialize with them and not worry about having somebody track you down and throw you out of school.
I had no idea that that what I was doing was trying to heal myself.
I mentioned to her that my best friend Brent probably would not be willing to date me because he did not want to be seen as a homewrecker. And she said to me, "Then I need to make a phone call." And she phoned Brent, and she set up my first date for Saturday night.
That's the thing about Mormonism that's so fundamentally destructive, is that it disrespects on a very basic level the right of people to voice their identity. They give lip service to individual identity, but they say, you're entitled to your views as long as you don't publicly express them. Who better than individuals to tell you who they are?
And it was a rebirth. It was a time of, like the cicada of after these years of being with Les and being so completely identified by who I was with him. I had never been completely self-identified. I had always been identified by the things I did, the people I loved, the people who loved me, the circumstances surrounding me.
And in Salt Lake, I was able to, I'd say, complete my coming out process to some degree, at least to myself and to a small group of friends.
I knelt down and prayed, and I just had to tell God, I've done all of this work, and now my emotions are clear, and I'm gay. I got an immediate answer back that is just like the answers I got to questions on my mission when big important questions came up. And that was, and it was an audible answer. It was, yes, you finally got it.
It literally is for me, a very specific stripping away of everything. So, more than a rebirth, it was simply a birth.
I was the last one to keep going with Evergreen. All of them, all 15 men, I think there was about 15 of us, had all stopped. I was the last one.
They would contact me and tell me, find a way to tell me that they had stopped, that they're gay. I attacked them with all the religious Mormon fervor that I had when they left. I said, I was just terrible. I wrote a letter to one of them, an email that was just disastrous to my friend Sean. Oh my God.
I sent Steve an email from gay.com and explained that this is who I am and I'm okay with that. I am out and I don't know if I asked you to support me in that or not, but the answer I got back was, oh my gosh, I can't believe you're doing this. I thought we believed in common values and that we were working for the same things. I can see now that you no longer believe that way, and it hurts me to see that you're just going to the dark side, basically. And it was about three short paragraphs.
And then I attacked you personally. The last couple of lines, I attacked you personally.
You're this and this, writing poetry based on false ideas and...
Can you believe that?
And bad emotional responses, and basically you're a hack in your life, and no wonder your life is nowhere. I will pray for you, and I will never speak to you again. I was sad to lose a friend, but we both had to do what we needed to do to survive.
You're experiencing D.C. with all these people, and you're feeling like you are not alone.
So, Capitol Building, Washington Monument, and us, and between the Capitol and the Monument, it was just full of gay people. At one point, I just stood up and I looked around, and for the first time in my life, realized I'm not alone. They were school teachers and accountants, and just as everybody was normal, and this is how normal I am.
Well, I don't really know. I look back and I don't know how I was that person. How the fuck was I ever that person? I don't even understand.
Mm-hmm.
And while I was doing it, while I was struggling to do the right thing, it turned me into such a terrible, I mean, I was just dealing with so much poison, you know?
Well, so much bitterness, so much fear, so much aloneness.
Well, and
you were
leaving. Everyone was leaving me. I was being alone. It was every single, all my friends were coming around and figuring themselves out, which is what I understand now. But one by one, I was just becoming even more isolated and more alone. There was nobody left. I was going to be the only one. And at the end, I was the only one. Plus, also, I was married and I had children, and I'm feeling gay, and I'm like, how am I supposed to navigate this? My kids are never going to understand if I ever do this. I wish I could do what you just did. I was mad, and then I was alone, and then I felt even more isolated.
It hurt, and I needed to get on with my life, and so I filed the letter away, and we never spoke again.
And I was very scared, because I really believed I would lose everything. I really believed that I would lose my soul, and that my children would go to hell, and that it would all burn up in flames. I believe that.
Oh, I think really what it is I really believed in the church. Like every single aspect of the church, I believed, literally. I never gave in to allegory, not once. I took all of that literally.
I'd woken up that morning and I said to Jenny, my ex, and I was totally honest. For the first time, I said, I am so unhappy. I had no gauge. I didn't have any feeling of where I was going to end up. I knew that maybe I could self-destruct. I mean, I don't know, but there was no way that it was going to ever be the same. That day came, and that was it. By that evening, I was driving along, listening to this music, and I thought, I have to call someone. Someone, there has to be someone that I can talk to right now who will not attack me, who is going to sit there and listen to me.
Hello, this is Tom. And I said, Tom Clark, and he said, yes.
He'd call some days on the phone, and I'd pick up that phone, and there wasn't a sound on the other end, and then the sobbing would start, and I know it was Steve, and I just sit there and listen.
He was saying, I know what you're going through, and it's going to be okay. You just have to trust that it's going to be okay.
I knew how much he was hurting. And I was so glad to have gotten past that, to be past the point of hurting like that, and so that I could just be there for him and just listen and just... Because had I still been hurting, I wouldn't have been able to listen to him sobbing on the other end of the phone.
I probably called him 4 or 5 times that way, or I didn't say anything. I just called him. I was a mess. It was disastrous. Because I couldn't even function. I couldn't even talk about it. But he slowly gave me lots of words of encouragement, and I slowly made it through that. I don't know how I made through that, because I really felt suicidal. I felt the worst I'd ever felt in my life.
That is the moment when people kill themselves. I'm telling you right now, that's the place, because I knew to call someone. I knew to reach out to somebody. In retrospect, the way that I felt inside was that everyone around me was watching me. I felt pressure that everyone was noticing what I was doing. The people knew that I was doing something terrible. What is it that happens to a person psychologically when they feel that making a choice as an adult becomes so huge. And it wasn't just the people, it was like the pressure of like legions of angels were watching me. I was a very, very devout Mormon. But in the end, the reason was because God could see me, because angels could see me, because it was being recorded in this book of life, because people could see me. It was tangible. I could feel it.
Never say never!
3 years later, out of the blue,
I felt terrible about what I had done to all these men. And, you know, I'm sure they're just, like, thinking, okay, well, he'll call me when the day comes, when he's done playing, you know, done pretending. And I contacted every single one of them that I could and made amends. An eternity, that's all I know.
It did seem like a long time. It was 2003, it was. I get this letter from Steve, this email, and it starts off, "Dear Sean..." It was, "Can you forgive me?" And he was in it, well, a slightly brighter place, but hello, difficult as hell. Holy cow. I remember reading the letter and just thinking, oh my gosh, because the wife, the kids, the church, the anger, the mom, oh my gosh, everything. It was bad. It was in a bad, bad, bad place.
It was pretty fucking bad.
It was. And so my response back was, "Dear Steve, yes, you are forgiven, so let's never speak of it again. How are you doing? What's going on?"
It was astoundingly important to me that you forgive me. And that was the first time in my life, through all the Mormon talks on forgiveness and everything else, that I actually felt and needed forgiveness from something. I don't want to forget that I did that to you. I don't want to forget that I was ever that kind of person, because it helps me remember how great my life is now.
Steve Lee and I get on the phone, and we're like silly little girls.
Aquaman t-shirts. I left a message for him the other day, and I said, "Tom, this is God calling. I have a commandment for you. You must go buy the new Rufus Wainwright album." So he called me back. Okay, I'm calling to tell God that I picked up the Rufus album, and he was right.
We just go on and laugh. From where he was at, what, 4 years ago, sobbing into the phone, unable to speak, unable to utter a single word. Today, his laughter on that phone is the most amazing reward, because he has a laugh that just lights my soul up. It's just the most beautiful thing.
"This is God calling again. Just wanted to make sure you weren't thinking you could get away with ignoring me."
End of message.
This is God calling again.
Sunday,
"You bred them, they bred you, swing from me once again. Thank God."
You've got far better resources now than I had 20 years ago when I was coming out. There's a lot more information out there. Make use of that information, and above all, just be safe.
And the funny thing is, you know, you take one step out and you challenge that, because you're so depressed you think, "I'd rather die than live with this." And so you're ready to die, and you're ready to do anything to make it stop. And you give it about a week, and then you don't die, and then you start, and then it starts to get kind of funny. And then you start to think, "Well, that's weird. I'm not dead yet."
My first experience with gay pride in Salt Lake, when I was on my way to church in my car and got stopped by the parade. So I've made quite a transition since then. Who's leading it? I'm happy to do it.
We would help you.
We're gonna get 100 people in the next little bit. Let's go. I think I was born for this.
favorite vacation spot in Arizona. I say, any highway on a motorcycle. See you later.
Come on in.
This is where Max sleeps.
This is Max's bed, isn't it?
Sometimes when I walk in the door, I feel like, whose house is this? I like this house. I mean, I didn't really think about it too much before getting here, partly because, you know, I was so excited that I didn't want to be disappointed. You know, we had imagined living together and, you know, having a place that was ours. And so it's really been pretty much a total blast.
I tell my kids now, the golden rule right now is to not hurt yourself and not to hurt other people. Do anything possible to remove yourself away from influences that attack and hurt you.
Stevie's flying in for the weekend. It's Pride weekend. This is amazing that he's going to be here Pride weekend. Okay, it's just like amazing. And I even brought along an extra sarong. Years ago, I used to see guys running around in sarongs during Pride, and I would think, God, you know, how queer is that? One of the things I love about Steve Lee, so many Steves, is he, this fire rages in him. And like me, he keeps it, you know, under wraps pretty much most of the time. And then every once in a while, it just flares up and it's just like, rah.
Why does it always have to be wanderlust? Sensational.
When you are in the arms of that person, whoever that person is, whatever your sexuality, when you are in the arms of that person where the expression is finally complete and authentic and coming from every place in your body, that is the moment that's worth living for.
I have two pieces of advice for you. Don't get married to a woman if you're gay, and don't ever join the Mormon Church. Those are the two. I share those with people at bars now.
Les and I had gone up to the Mugeon Rim, up into the big ponderosa pine forests up there in central Arizona, and we would lay there under the stars at night, and I could hear the wind whistling in the tall trees, and that sound is sort of a mournful sound. But I resonate with it. And it seems very appropriate here.
But with all the, you know, the vast space out here, what we're sitting in here is a little confined spot with a wrought iron fence entrapping us, if you will. But you look out beyond this fence, and the wind blows free. Yeah. And there are places to go, and there are trails to explore. And it's interesting, you walk out of the of this enclosure, and there's a little sign on the gate that says, please close the gate behind you. So Tom's done it, he's moved on.